Well, taking up the reading again, so you see, this is the meaning that is impacted into this single phrase, a descent of the infinite into the apparent finiteness of name and form. But it is a veiled manifestation, and there is a gradation between the supreme being of the divine and the consciousness, shrouded partly or wholly by ignorance of self, of the self in the finite. So now you see, what all we described is exactly this sentence alone, that there is a veiled manifestation, a gradation between the supreme being of the divine and the self. And why this gradation needs to be known is, normally in India, the common man would say, hey, it is Brahman who has become the world, and we think that somewhere the Brahman, you know, he decided to become the world and manifest the world, and he started. Like we have in Christianity, in the Bible, God said, let there be light, and there was light, and then there was all this creation. But maybe from our Indian point of view, it could be said, Brahman said, let there be darkness, and then there was the darkness. So our manifestation, our concept, and the biblical concept are pretty different. And especially with Sri Aurobindo, this question of let there be darkness could be true, because Sri Aurobindo gives us the different steps. What is important is to know this line of descent. Otherwise, you see, philosophically, if you don't know the lines of coming down, the steps of coming down, then you wouldn't know the steps of going up. You see, it's a simple logic. In the ancient Hinduism or other religions or yogas or whatever, we said God became the earth. But how does God became man? But how does man become God? The secret is not revealed. So Sri Aurobindo gives us these lines of the descent, the staircase downward. So when Sri Aurobindo claims that man can become God, that man is a potential God in the making, then if you say how, he will say this way. This is the staircase that comes down, and the same steps are used to go up, for going up. So that is why this concept of the descent and the staircase details are of extreme importance for Sri Aurobindo's philosophy as well as Sri Aurobindo's yoga. That's why we have to take off a little bit to get into the details. Now, the conscious embodied soul is a spark of the divine fire, and that soul in man opens out to self-knowledge as it develops out of ignorance of self into self-being. So we have just covered this. The conscious embodied soul is the spark of the divine fire. This word here, the spark of the embodied soul, there's a footnote calling Dehi. So this embodied soul is the spark of the divine fire, and that soul in man opens out to self-knowledge. You see, somebody was asking the question, now what we have spoken about the Jivatman becoming the psychic being, what about the soul? Well, it should be clear now that Jivatman comes down as the soul, the spark of the divine fire. But as it evolves through evolution, through matter, through life, through animal, and when it comes to man, then the same spark of the soul is called the psychic being. So it is only nomenclature that changes. Or should we say it this way? You know, the spark of the soul is, if you see a bulb, you know, inside the bulb we have that, what is that called? Tungsten, right? Which gives you the light, which really catches the electricity and gives the light. But that tungsten, that little part of that gives light, if it doesn't have the bulb over it, you don't get light. That bulb, that form is the psychic being. That tungsten or whatever the material that is catching the divine spark or the electricity is the divinity. But this divinity, this spark, when it comes to the human level, it gets a form, formation. What the Upanishads say, it is the height of the thumb, angushta matre. So this is the form. That form, the bulb outside, is a psychic being. So you can imagine the internal relation between the bulb form and the tungsten. So you cannot have one without the other. It is of no use. Just if there is bulb and there is no light inside, it is of no use. So this is how we say, what Sri Aurobindo is telling us, is that that soul is the spark of the divine fire, and that soul in man opens out to self-knowledge as it develops out of ignorance and ignorance of self into self-being. So there is an evolution of the psychic being. And as the evolution progresses, what happens? This bulb, in the beginning it is maybe 10 watts. And most of the human beings have this 10 watts bulb, I suppose. It's not powerful. It doesn't have any effectivity. It's there as a light. But with the evolution, this 10 watts become 20 and then 40 and then 60 and then 80 and 100 watts. The power of effectivity increases. The power of the bulb means the power of effectivity. If there's 100 watts there, the whole hall becomes lighted. If there's just 10 watts, it doesn't have any effect in this darkness. So what Sri Aurobindo is telling us about the developing out of ignorance of self into self-being. So gradually, this power increases in its effectivity. And ultimately, it realizes its own parent body called the Jivatman. So the journey of the psychic being is to go back to its parent, the Jivatman. Because it's the Jivatman which has sent this delegate into evolution, saying, go into the world and do my work. So every Jivatman, being an individual self of the divine, has got a different purpose on this earth. We may be all Aurobindonians, fine, very nice. But to manifest the Sri Aurobindo's vision, all our souls have got a different function. Somebody manifests it through taking classes, somebody goes to the embroidery department, somebody goes to the dining room, somebody goes there. But we all manifest the same purpose, but we have a different role to play on this world, on this earth. The divine also, pouring itself into the forms of the cosmic existence, is revealed ordinarily in an efflorescence of its powers, in energies and magnitudes of its knowledge, love, joy, developed force of being, in degrees and faces of its divinity. Well, it falls in line with what you have just discussed. The one is the psychic being in the individual, what we said, the fourth line of the descent. Then this psychic being can go back. Then there is also this possibility that the divine comes to us as vibhutis. And of course, we are not taking up the Bhagavad Gita, but later on, there is a chapter on the vibhutis. I don't know if it is there in part 1 or part 2. But he comes to us as vibhutis. So that could be between 4 and 5 what we just now discussed. We did not bring in this concept of vibhuti, we went straight to the direct concept of avatar. So you could perhaps add in, between the fourth and the fifth, there is another point, that of the vibhutis. And here, so in energies and magnitudes of his knowledge, love, joy, developed force of being. So these vibhutis are of the Purusha, and they can be vibhutis of Ishwari, of Shakti. So this is kind of the intermediary. He is not a full descent of an avatar, but one aspect, one power, one little work. And this vibhuti comes and prepares for the coming avatar, or he enhances the work of the past avatar. So in between the coming of two avatars, there's lots and lots of vibhutis who come. Like the great Vivekananda himself was a vibhuti. Like the great Shankaracharya himself was a vibhuti. So they are not avatars. Sri Ramakrishna was an avatar, but Vivekananda was a vibhuti. And why was he necessary? To enhance the work that Sri Ramakrishna brought as an avatar. So also you don't know how many vibhutis have come with Mother and Sri Aurobindo to take their work forward. So this is always the case, that the avatar comes with his vibhutis who help in the anchoring of the force of the avatar onto the earth. So that is their role. Napoleon himself was a great vibhuti. And I'm sure Leonardo da Vinci could have been another great vibhuti. So these are personalities who are really anchoring the divine consciousness on the earth. And then of course in a chapter, Lord Krishna himself tells us all these different kinds of vibhutis he has come as. Of course we do not have a list here. I do not have the time to go into that list, but you can all go into that vibhutis chapter. And then comes the third level. But when the divine consciousness and power, taking upon itself the human form and the human mode of action, possesses it not only by powers and magnitudes, by degrees and outward faces of itself, but out of its eternal self-knowledge, when the unborn knows itself and acts in the frame of the mental being and the appearance of birth, that is the height of the conditioned manifestation. It is the full and conscious descent of the Godhead. It is the avatar. So that is what we said, level 5. The consciousness and power, when it comes and intervenes this evolution directly, when the unborn knows itself and acts in the frame of the mental being. So that is when God becomes man, comes as man, and putting upon himself the whole human nature, please remember that. He does not come down with a glorious body, with a wonderful mind, with a this and that. That is why when people complain, why was Sri Ram so very sentimental towards Sita? He even wept about Sita when she was in Sri Lanka and all that. Because we always think that avatar is somebody up there and he has no human emotions. Then he should not have been an avatar. Because he will cry as you and me cry. He suffers on his body as you and me suffer. The only thing is, because he is inwardly awakened, he can control himself. But when Sri Aurobindo had a teardrop when his wife passed away, so it's nothing abnormal or something unexpected. Because after all, he is the avatar in the human form and the human name and the human character. So that is one thing we should not forget. And you know, Sri Aurobindo going to London and getting that all that education, people say, why he was an avatar, he couldn't have got it. No. You see, avatars are not freaks of nature. They want to come inside within the human community and take the human community out. So therefore he would say that he comes into the frame of the mental being and the appearance of birth. That is the height of the conditioned manifestation. Well, we have in fact very good chapters. I can see here chapter 15 and maybe chapter 16 are full length articles on avatarhood. So we will wait till then. We means I do not know how many of us, but at least I will be taking up this chapters as we go along. Now the next para. The Vaishnava form of Vedantism, which has laid most stress upon this conception, expresses the relation of God in man to man in God by the double figure of Naranarayana. Associated historically with the origin of a religious school very similar in its doctrines to the teachings of the Gita. Nara is the human soul, which eternal companion of the divine finds itself only when it awakens to that companionship and begins, as the Gita would say, to live in God. Narayana is the divine soul, always present in our humanity, the secret guide, friend and helper of the human being. Lord, who abides within the heart of creatures of the Gita, when within us the veil of that secret sanctuary is withdrawn and man speaks face to face with God, hears the divine voice, receives the divine light, acts in the divine power, then becomes possible the supreme uplifting of the embodied human conscious being into the unborn and eternal. He becomes capable of that dwelling in God and giving up his whole consciousness into the divine, which the Gita upholds as the best or highest secret of things, uttamam rahasyam. Well, of course, this is a different concept of Vaishnavism, wherein we have this relation between Nara and Narayana. The Nara being the human soul and Narayana the supreme soul, the divine soul. And the interplay between them, how Nara appeals to Narayana and how Narayana utilizes the Nara to manifest himself. So there is this sweet play of love, of lovers between the Nara and Narayana. So this is a concept that has been talked about in the Gita, and we have in our country, in some parts of the country, a lot of people practice this Vaishnavism. So this is something Sri Aurobindo says, when this Nara, the human soul, merges itself in that Narayana, that is the self-identification, that is the highest secret or the uttamam rahasyam. When this eternal divine consciousness always present in the human being, this God in man takes possession partly or wholly of the human consciousness and becomes in visible human shape the guide, teacher, leader of the world, not as those who living in their humanity yet feel something of the power or light or love of the divine gnosis informing and conducting them, but out of the divine gnosis itself, direct from its central force and plenitude, then we have the manifest of the. Well, you know what we said here, the Narayana is not the outside, outer physical God. The Narayana is the indwelling Godhead. So that is why there could be a relation between Nara and Narayana, that is between my psychic being, the soul, and myself. So in our own terms of Sri Aurobindo, we could say, it is realizing your own psychic being. That is the relation of Nara and Narayana. But then Sri Aurobindo goes to say that when this indwelling divinity comes out means not coming out from me, but right direct from the Supreme, he is there eternally within us. The indwelling deity or Narayana is there within us. But then the same deity descends with his entire power and knowledge. When he comes as the outer divinity, then you call him the avatar. When he is there as your inner divinity, you call him as the indwelling deity, you call him the soul, you call him the psychic being, whatever. So you can see one is an eternal process of human evolution, and the other is the intervention in human evolution. So an avatar is always an intervention in human evolution or earth's evolution, whereas the indwelling deity is not an intervention. It's a continuum. It's a continuum because the psychic being goes after the death, comes back. So there's a continuum maintained, whereas the avatar is an intervention. The inner divinity is the eternal avatar in man. The human manifestation of its sign and development in the external world. So we have here a greater clarity. The indwelling deity is called the eternal avatar, and the outer avatar is the incarnation who comes time to time. And if you had noted one thing in my reading yesterday, Sri Aurobindo does note that in this Kali Yuga, avatar comes again and again. It is not as we have been expecting that in the Dwapara he came one, and in Treta he came once, and in the Satya he came once. But Kali Yuga he comes more often, because there is much more work to be done now. So you can understand why Sri Ramakrishna came, and why Sri Aurobindo has come, and why another avatar is coming. Because in the Kali, which is the darkest period of evolution, of the evolutionary cycle, does also have the golden seeds of the next Satya Yuga. So you see, before the rains come, the farmer plows the land and puts the seed in. So when the rains come, the harvest comes up there. So to the avatars, this is the darkest period, and they come, put or sow the golden seeds, which when they grow, they become the new Satya Yuga. So it is kind of, you know, the divine does a lot of work during this period of the Kali Yuga. And also, he notes in some other letters that in Kali Yuga or during Kali Yuga, the human being suffers so much because of all the violence and the destruction and all the corruption and the collapse of the values and all that. What we say, Ghor Kali Yuga. At such a time, there is the necessity of the descent of the divine as the mother. This is because the human beings, when they are suffering, they are most comfortable in the lap of a mother. So he would say, this mother who has come, the Aditi who has taken this, come down as the avatar, this has been done precisely during the Kali Yuga. She did not come during Dwapara or Treta or during the Satya, which as yugas they must have been, they may have been more wonderful. They are and they were. But they did not have the footsteps of this mother who has come only in the Kali Yuga. So this is why he would say that there are these different levels of the avatar. And sometimes it does happen that there is a partial avatar also. Maybe he will take it up later. Like we have the Chaitanya. So you see, we have different types of avatarhood itself. We have the vibhutis who come for a particular purpose, a ray of a divine consciousness. We have the partial avatar when the human soul is so open to the divine, so evolved that it opens itself to the divine. And like Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he was the divine and the disciple together. Sometimes he would be the divine, other times he would be the disciple. That is, when the Lord possessed him, the Lord came down, thrust himself into the psychic being of Chaitanya. He was endowed with his divine capacities and power and consciousness. But when the power withdrew, then he became the disciple. So that was a unique case in the history of spirituality in India, at least, when we have both the divine and the disciple in a single body. And then, of course, We have all these vibhutis which I have spoke of, and then there are these avatars, and even amongst avatars, the avatar of the motherhood is unique only in Kali Yuga. Now we go to a very interesting paragraph, pretty much out of this concept of avatarhood, not out of this concept, but still another aspect, if I can say. When we thus understand the conception of avatarhood, we see that whether for the fundamental teaching of the Gita, our present subject, or for spiritual life generally, the external aspect has only a secondary importance. So this Sri Aurobindo, this he is telling us very bluntly. And we see the same sentence being applied to his own life, that the external aspect of the avatar is secondary in importance when it comes to spiritual life. You see, it is the politicians who play upon this Ram Janmabhoomi and his birthday and this and that. It is a political affair. But what have I got to do with, if I have to realize Sri Ram within my consciousness? It may be in Ayodhya, or it is maybe in Tamil Nadu, or it may be Gujarat, or it may be Bengal. It doesn't matter to me. Because what have I got to do with the historical evidence of an avatar? Ultimately, Sri Aurobindo would go to that level, that for a spiritual realization, these external facts and figures of avatar are not important. That's why both the mother and Sri Aurobindo were insistently against any biography being written about their lives. Because they don't want the future of humanity to remember their external features. Because they may take away the fundamental importance of their consciousness, of their work, of the yoga that they want us to do. Instead of that, if we keep on saying, mother did that, Sri Aurobindo did that, mother, he was a revolutionary, he was this. It's good to know their work, but the details of life do not have much importance. In fact, we have learned, I'm afraid, this trick or this trade of this biography of an avatar or the biography of a great man from the West. It's the West which really emphasizes upon these biographical details. It may be Shakespeare, who has been dug up from his grave, I don't know how many hundreds of times. It may be another author, it may be another poet. We want to get into the intricate details of what Einstein did, did he have a girlfriend or did he have a second wife? What does it matter? And especially for an avatar, it has no relevance at all. So Sri Aurobindo writes here straight away, for spiritual life generally, the external aspect has only a secondary importance. Such controversies as the one that has raged in Europe over the historicity of Christ would seem to a spiritually minded Indian largely a waste of time. He would concede to it a considerable historical but hardly any religious importance. For what does it matter in the end whether a Jesus, son of the carpenter Joseph, was actually born in Nazareth or in Bethlehem, lived and taught and was done to death on a real or a trumped up charge of sedition? So long as we can know by spiritual experience the inner Christ, live uplifted in the light of his teaching and escape from the yoke of the natural law by that atonement of man with God of which the crucifixion is the symbol. You see, this is the magnificent interpretation. If Christ came to deliver you out of this ignorance, if he came to awaken your psychic being, Christ represented the awakening of the psychic love. So let that love be awakened within you. And not just all the time saying, we are sinners, Christ died on the cross and we are sinners, we put the sinner on our chest. You see, all that becomes religiosity. We are missing the kernel and we are going on the cover. So the inner Christ, if you want to give an importance to your avatar, then why don't we take the the spirit of the avatar, the teachings, what he came for, what he wants us to do in our life, instead of making a waste of time to dig up his grave and say, was he born here, or did he die there, did he go here, who was their parent? They may have some historical relevance, but for a spiritual seeker, for a historian, for a politician, for a social philosopher, all that is good. But if you want to do sadhana, this external life has no relevance at all. That's why, perhaps, I understand this so well in the sense, not in the wrong sense, but when I compare it to what Sri Aurobindo and the mother have said about their own life, then we understand why Sri Aurobindo is writing about this external life of the avatar. And especially for sadhana, it matters little. So, if the Christ, God made man, lives within our spiritual being, it would seem to matter little whether or not a son of Mary physically lived and suffered and died in Judea. So too the Krishna who matters to us is the eternal incarnation of the divine and not the historical teacher and leader of men. So you see, Sri Aurobindo, while giving us, as we did yesterday, giving us proof of the historical Krishna, tells us everything about his reality, his historical birth, etc. But still, when it comes to inspire the sadhak, the spiritual person, he says what is important is the eternal incarnation of the divine. Who is that eternal incarnation? The inner Sri Krishna. So when we read the Bhagavad Gita, let's not get into the details of his birth and of what he did, the playful things about the gopikas and the dances and all that. They are there good for your poetry, for your sculpture, for your painting, for your dances. Because all these themes of gopikas and all that, they have become part of our cultural ethos. But a good dancer in Bharatanatyam depicting Sri Krishna's dance with the gopikas is not necessarily a sadhika or a sadhak. So what Sri Aurobindo is telling us is to really live and emphasize upon the inner Krishna, the inner Christ. And not even in Europe, 80% of European paintings that I've seen in the museums are all about Christ. So maybe for that it is good to have this his biographical details, because they become the theme of a cultural aesthetic development. Like Krishna and Sri Ram have become the theme of our own cultural ethos. But for spirituality, it has a secondary importance. In fact, we who are in the beginning of this, of the life of an avatar, participating in the life of an avatar, I think it is a kind of a suggestion to us that how we should take Sri Aurobindo and the mother in their essence and not embellish their outer life and perpetuate their outer life significance. Because down the line, after 100 years, 200 years, whatever the time, people may forget the real Sri Krishna, the real Sri Aurobindo, the inner mother, the psychic being, and follow the outer things. So there is a danger in that. It may be historically good, but for sadhana, not important. Now, the next para that we have seen, we have here, I did cover yesterday, when we are dealing with the historical Krishna, that how we have the proofs of Sri Krishna's birth and existence in Chandogya Upanishad, and in the religion of Bhagavata religion, and in the Mahabharata, etc. So, I skip this paragraph, and I come to the next para. But all this, though of considerable historical importance, has none whatever for our present purpose. We are concerned only with the figure of the divine teacher as it is presented to us in the Gita and with the power for which it there stands in the spiritual illumination of the human being. So Sri Aurobindo, as he has said in the chapter 1, our demand and need from the Gita, he always insists that what he wants to do is, I quote from the last paragraph of the first chapter, our object then in studying the Gita will not be a scholastic or academical scrutiny of its thought, nor to place its philosophy in the history of metaphysical speculation, nor shall we deal with it in the manner of any analytical dialectism. We approach it for help and light, and our aim must be to distinguish its essential and living message, that in it on which humanity has to seize for its perfection and its highest spiritual welfare. So you see, this is his central objective. So although he touches upon the historicity of Sri Krishna, that's only more for your interest and our interest. But he says, my interest is not to develop this and to get into this scholastic or academic scrutiny, because that is not, that can be a waste of time. You know, many people have done that. So he says, I'm here trying to bring out the eternal, the central message of the Gita, which will help us in our spiritual life. No more and no less than that. So that's what he repeats here in this paragraph that I'm reading, that we will seek that power for which it there stands in the spiritual illumination of the being. Because by the time you go to the middle of this book, you will see that how much he has spoken about the yoga of Sri Krishna, if I can say. So it is, Sri Aurobindo is concentrating here on the yoga of the Gita. It's not the Bhagavad Gita for the sake of, that's why he did not give here a translation of the 700 verses one by one and trying to expand like most of these interpreters have done. They take up one shloka, give it translation, then and give the main idea. That would have been a scholastic thing. That would not have brought out the gems of the Gita. So that's why Sri Aurobindo writes essays on the Gita, which down the line, here and there, they do cover the translations. There has been one disciple who has culled out this translation and put them under the verses of the Bhagavad Gita. But it is not the way Sri Aurobindo did. So here, he says, the Gita accepts the human avatarhood, for the Lord speaks of the repeated, the constant manifestation of the divine in humanity. When he, the eternal unborn, assumes by his Maya, by the power of the infinite consciousness, to clothe itself apparently in finite forms, the conditions of becoming which we call birth. But it is not this upon which stress is laid, but on the transcendent, the cosmic and the eternal divine. It is on the source of all things and the master of all, and on the Godhead's secret in man. I mean, it throws a lot of light on the Gita and our understanding of the teacher of the Gita. Because here also, we should not go by Sri Krishna the avatar. You see, constantly when we read the Gita, we think Sri Krishna the avatar is speaking all this. But Sri Aurobindo is telling us, take away the focus. Because he says, although Gita accepts the concept of avatar and even describes how out of my Mama Maya that the Lord has brought forth this universe, he says the focus that Sri Krishna is giving us is not on himself as the avatar. You see, that's a grand point to note and to remember. It is not that he is wanting to create another religion upon himself, saying, look, I am the avatar, I start Sri Krishna movement or whatever the movement. Because no avatar ever starts a religion. You have seen Sri Ram, Sri Krishna, Sri Aurobindo. They did not leave behind a religion. It's the others who have left behind a religion. It's the human beings who are making them into a religion. But there's no Sri Krishna religion. There's Sri Krishna's teaching and vision and power and consciousness. So he says, that the stress is laid on the transcendent, the cosmic, the internal divine. Later on in the last chapters, we have the core of the Gita, etc. We have the three great secrets of the Gita. The first secret is the realization of the Atman, the soul, the internal divine. The second secret is the cosmic Krishna, realizing the cosmic. And the third secret is to unite yourself with the Purushottama. So even the Lord Krishna, this is a beautiful thing that we need to note, because it has a parallel in Sri Aurobindo. That being the avatar himself, he is not stressing upon himself. He is not asking Arjuna and the disciples to focus on Sri Krishna, the avatar. He says, find out Sri Krishna, the immanent Godhead. I am within you. Find me out there. Otherwise, if you focus on Sri Krishna, the avatar, the external form, you are bound to make it into a religion. What we have done now with Hare Rama, Hare Krishna. We have made it, clothed it richly in rich garment, a beautiful religion. But Sri Krishna never said that. He wants us to realize the inner divine. And why I am saying is interesting, because we here have the same parallel in Madhava and Sri Aurobindo. They themselves being the avatars, they are not saying worship us. They are saying discover me within you. The mother said, I am within you. Go deep inside the temple and you will find me there. So that is what is the beauty. We see the avatar. He says, find me within you. Long back when I was in Oroville, I written a letter to the mother, something of this. Mother said, yes, I am aware of everything. I am not far from what is happening in the ashram. But find me within. Because we are also accustomed to seeing the mother without. In the balcony, on the terrace darshan, in the sports ground, in here, in there. But then she withdrew slowly. For a number of years she did not come down from this upstairs room. Only on our birthdays we saw her and on the darshan days we saw. But that was a slow withdrawal, as she said, in order to train us to see her within. So it was a wonderful plan. It is not that the mother left us suddenly. There was a time period of withdrawal. So this is what an avatar does normally. That find me within you. And that's what Sri Krishna said. It is on the source of all things and the master of all and on the Godhead secret in man. It is this internal divinity who is meant when the Gita speaks of the doer of violent asuric austerities, troubling the God within, or of the sin of those who despise the divine lodged in the human body, or of the same Godhead destroying our ignorance by the blazing lamp of knowledge. So when Sri Krishna is speaking about this, you know, he, of course, if somebody has time and could really relate all this to the actual verses, I didn't have the time to do that, but it could be a good homework for some people. Because he says that those who really hate the divine are sinners. Not those who reject Sri Krishna, the avatar. He is not taking the importance on himself, that if you don't accept me, you are a sinner. No. He is not an egoistic avatar. He says, if you don't accept the inner divine, then you are a sinner. So you see how Indian spirituality is so Catholic. I can reject the avatar Sri Krishna, it doesn't matter. As long as I can go to the inner Sri Krishna, the outer Sri Krishna is not important. And that the Lord himself is telling us. So he says, it is the internal divinity who is meant, not the outer. When he is saying that those who despise the divine lodged in the human body, that he is a sinner. So you see the magnificent emphasis. So all the outer drama of Sri Krishna is all the time constantly to remind us that get me within. All these Navaratri dances that we see in Gujarat, these wonderful dances, dances with Gopikas. I mean, you look at this fantastic symbolism that Shri Krishna is dancing with every Gopika. How can it be? Physically, it's not possible. But see the symbology that I am within each one of you. And I am, the question of dancing is guiding. I am playing with you. And I am with you. So this is the symbology of that beautiful Gopika dances. But if we make it into only a regular annual custom of dancing and then rest of the year we don't look into Shri Krishna within, then it becomes a dead thing. Therefore we just emphasize upon the Gopikas and Krishna and then, you know, all the Dwarakas and all that we go and visit. But constantly says, realize me within. It is then that the eternal avatar, this God in man, the divine consciousness, always present in the human being, who manifested in a visible form, speaks to the human soul in the Gita, illumines the meaning of life and the secret of divine action, and gives it the light of divine knowledge and guidance, and the assuring and fortifying word of the Master of Existence in the hour when it comes face to face with the painful mystery of the world. You see, we may say the eternal Godhead is within. What is the necessity of an avatar? If God is there always within us, that I can speak to Him, I can dance with Him, I can really chat with Him, then why this external descent of the avatar? Here is the answer. That when there is a painful mystery of the world, he calls it. When there is an aggrandizement of sin, adharma. You see, when the human beings themselves are under the yoke of this adharma, they are not able to contact in spite of the tapasya, in spite of the meditations, in spite of that. The adharma has increased so much, it has become a burden on man, and man is not able even to contact the inner divine. So the avatar comes to remove those hurdles, to remove that adharma, to remove that weighing thing upon your psychic being, and he once again makes a path to your own inner divinity. And what we have in Savitri hews a new path. The role, the mission of Savitri is to hew new paths into the spirituality. This is what the divine does. He clears the path back into your psychic being. Because, you know, over generations, over centuries, there is this vital, the inconscient, all that again comes up, and man is overburdened with this asuric, with this titanic, with this satanic, with this inconscient thing. So that is called adharma. So Lord says, I come to remove that adharma. So spiritually is nothing. But to make that channel once again, you know, that the channel was clogged. So the avatar comes, and what Shrivananda writes here, that he gives you that with divine knowledge and guidance and assuring and fortitude word. So he speaks to you so strongly, so clearly, that the channel, the tunnel is cleansed. And again we see the same thing Mother and Sri Aurobindo have done. You see, we say Sri Aurobindo has all the Vedanta in him. The Upanishads are there. The Gita is the starting point. Is Sri Aurobindo something new? You see, there cannot be anything new in the eternal spiritual truths. The Brahman cannot be renewed with every avatar. The cosmic concept cannot be renewed. The psychic being cannot be renewed. So if Sri Aurobindo speaks of the discovery and the realization of the psychic, it can be as old as Shri Krishna or as old as Upanishad. But as we said, through the centuries, the path becomes clogged. So an avatar is the one who alone can remake the path. There are vibhutis who maybe take away a little bit of the dust. There are maybe saints who tell you, look, back into the psychic being. So we should not say, hey, what did Sri Aurobindo tell us? He told me what my master has said. You know, a lot of people talk to me, oh, my master also says you must realize the psychic being. Fine. It's not just the master saying. It is this master doing it for you. That's the difference. Other gurus may tell you to go there. But this master, this lord of yoga, and by the way, why is he called a lord of yoga? Shri Krishna is called the lord of yoga. And Sri Aurobindo uses also the same term. That is because this lord, the avatar, he does yoga proper. He becomes the master of his own yoga. And that is why we call an avatar the lord of yoga. Because he undergoes the whole process of yoga on himself. Shri Krishna also did yoga. He was not just all the time playing with gopikas. He underwent a thorough process of yoga. So did Mother and Sri Aurobindo. So did Sri Ramakrishna. So you see, these are called the Lord of Yoga. And so that by their tapasya, they cleanse the human soul. And wherever anybody wants to realize the psychic being, now he says, I have laid the path, I have cleaned the path, you can go back to it. So he says, this is what the Indian religious consciousness seeks, to make near to itself in whatever form, whether in the symbolic human image it enshrines in its temples, or in the worship of its avatar, or in the devotion to the human guru, through whom the voice of the one world teacher makes itself heard. Through this, it strives to awaken to that inner voice, unveil that form of the formless, and stand face to face with a manifest divine power, love and knowledge. So our Indian spirituality is a magnificent system if you want to realize the divine. No other culture has given to its people this clarity, this intensity of the path. Other avatars have told us, I am the path, I am the gate, I am the end, I am the beginning. Fine. But in India, the path of yoga has been given. You see, too, if an avatar says, I am the path, and if the disciple says, Lord, what is the path? You may say, read my Bible, read my Quran, read my Tripitaka. It's not just reading, you have to see the process. And that process is called yoga. And that yoga goes beyond any religion. Why is it that yoga is becoming so very popular in whatever way it is in the whole world? Because yoga is one universal path, irrespective of the belief that you have, irrespective of the God you believe in. That is the path. And that's what I at least realized when I recently, a few months back, was in Bangladesh. There were so many Muslim devotees who had turned to Mother and Sri Aurobindo and taken so very full-heartedly to Mother and Sri Aurobindo. And when I asked the secret, he said, one of them, very knowledgeable, if not knowledgeable, at least educated man, I would say, he said, sir, I believe in Islam. I know that Allah is the goal. But Sri Aurobindo is the path. Perfect truth, perfect synthesis. He didn't want to leave his Allah, because the ideal of Islam is to realize and to serve his Allah. But they lack this path, this goal, and this path. So they have taken the yoga of Sri Aurobindo, integral yoga, and they have no compunctions. That is why we say yoga is universal. All that you say, Brahman and Sachidananda and Allah and Christ, they could have religious shades. But to say, follow this path of surrender and aspiration and rejection, who would say no? In this aspiration and surrender and rejection and concentration, meditation and renunciation, there's no Godhead mentioned. It is all a process to go within. So a Muslim can take this or a Christian can take this without having any clash with their own inner feelings for their own religion. So Sri Aurobindo is telling us, this is what Indian religious consciousness seeks. How to take the human being towards the divine. So they have given you the first outer form of the Guru. That's why India is galore with gurus. Then beyond the guru is the avatar. You worship the avatar. And then there could be a symbolic human image of the great Godhead or the avatar in a temple. One is an avatar like that. You don't have a temple for Sri Aurobindo and the mother. So it could be a direct relation with the avatar of Krishna or Rama without the structure of a temple or a church or a mosque. But then if you want to go to a Sri Krishna temple, by all means, that is only a symbolic image. But the more you go toward the outer, the greater is your paraphernalia of religion comes in. You go to Sri Krishna temple, then you have all the paraphernalia. There also you have a pujari. You have to do this, you have to do that. Because the outer means the religious practices. The inner means no religious practices. It is more a direct thing. So Sri Aurobindo is telling that Indian spirituality has taken the society by steps. That's why the Western world speakers of seekers of spirituality, they all come to find gurus in India. They don't go to Bangkok or Ethiopia or Indonesia or Japan or Russia. Because this has been our tradition. First the guru, then the avatar, then the Godhead in the temple, and then the transcendent beyond the temple. So this is the tiered structure of Indian spirituality. And mankind can follow this. So through these it strives to awaken to that inner voice, unveil that form of the formless, and stand face to face with that manifest divine power, love and knowledge. So he doesn't say stand face to face with Sachidananda. It is the impersonal divine power, knowledge and love. So you see, if only we can go within. Hinduism has been encrusted with this paraphernalia. Buddhism, although it didn't want to go to Bangkok, you will see, it is inundated with Hindu customs. Christianity is full of customs and creeds and dogmas and all that. So spirituality wants to liberate itself from all these outer meshes. And therefore it says, we have to stand ultimately face to face with the divine power, love and knowledge. Well, in the next paragraph, we come back to another aspect of Sri Krishna. You see, what we have been seeing is different aspects. We saw yesterday the political, historical Sri Krishna. We have seen today the avatar Sri Krishna. And avatar, what is he telling you? To go to the Supreme, not to come to him directly. So also the mother and Sri Aurobindo have always pointed the finger to the divine. You see, in the Life Divine or Synthesis of Yoga or in Letters on Yoga, nowhere he says, come to me. Come to the divine, he says. So that is the true avatar who directs you to the divine. But it is that guru is one who directs the disciple to himself. That's the difference between a guru and the divine and an avatar. Now in this para, we have Sri Krishna's another aspect. The aspect of the guide, the leader. And this is, of course, most of us know, because these are stories from Mahabharata. How he was the leader. I'll just read out a couple of sentences for you to follow what it means. That action is the action of a whole world of men and nations, some of whom have come as helpers of an effort and result by which they do not personally profit, and to these he is a leader, some as his opponents, and to them he is also an opponent, the baffler of their designs and their slayer, and he seems even to some of them an instigator of all evil and destroyer of their old order and familiar world and secure conventions of virtue and good. Some are representatives of that which has to be fulfilled, and to them he is a counselor, helper, friend. See, this paragraph is especially a wonderful synopsis of Shri Krishna in the Mahabharata, not Shri Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita. So he has been an opponent, he has been a slayer, he has been a leader, he has been a helper, he has been a friend. So the multiple roles of Shri Krishna are given in that Mahabharata. And that is again the greatness of Mahabharata, to show that how the divine comes close to you. Divine avatar. He is not standing in a pedestal and say, I am the avatar, all of you come to me. Avatar always goes to humankind. So he is the helper, he is an opponent, he is a lover, he is a friend, he is a dancer. Because he wants to mingle with you. Being one with humanity, he wants to take humanity to the Supreme One. This is the wonderful play between the avatar and the human beings. So all these things that are there, you just recollect your Mahabharata and you will see. I don't have time to get into all that. Where the action pursues its natural course, or the doers of the work have to suffer at the hands of its enemies and undergo the ordeals which prepare them for mastery, the avatar is unseen or appears only for occasional comfort and aid, but at every crisis his hand is felt, yet in such a way that all imagine themselves to be the protagonists, and even Arjuna, his nearest friend and chief instrument, does not perceive that he is an instrument, and has to confess at last that all the while he did not really know his divine friend. You see, this is the wonderful thing. I think I love these paragraphs, because when I read this, I only remember the mother and Sri Aurobindo. That how the mother has played all these roles. Silently she has helped people, directly she has helped people. Sometimes she says unseen, sometimes giving an occasional comfort. And Shri Krishna has done all this. To the extent, as he says wonderfully, Arjuna thought he is the great hero. He is the warrior. And sometimes he even, you know, talked so very casually to Shri Krishna. At the end he says, I'm sorry. I didn't know you are the avatar. I thought you were my friend. So I was so casual with you. So you see, Shri Krishna could be so casual. Otherwise, amongst friendship, if there's no freedom of speech and casualness, it's not friendship. But Shri Krishna and Arjuna are known to be the best of friends. And we will see in the next chapter why Arjuna was supposed to be a friend. So here we see all these roles. And this para stands merged with Mahabharata. But at the same time, this para can elucidate all the roles that Mother and Sri Aurobindo have played in our own life. Every word that is there, we can find an incident. Speak to the old ashramites, speak to the old books that are coming out, take out these reminiscences of the sadhaks. You see the avatar doing the same thing. I mean, this is magnificent in a sense. Sri Aurobindo is telling how the mother and Sri Aurobindo themselves came so close to us. I mean, they were father to somebody, they were mother to somebody, they were guru to somebody, they were gods to somebody. They are friends to some people, they are colleagues with some people. And the mother kept that friendship. When the Japanese friend came, she did not say, you are my Godhead, you are my divinity, you are my avatar. She welcomed this Japanese friend just as you and me would welcome a friend to my house, give them a cup of tea, make them comfortable, chat with them. So did she. So this is the multiple aspect of an avatar which no guru ever can really think of because he is not that multiple aspected. So the mother, I mean there are so many incidents. If you start going into that, we will never be able to take up the essays on the Gita. We will have to take up maybe chapters on the life divine and chapters on the mother's life. So I'm just controlling myself, controlling my throat and my voice and my heart not to speak out. He has received counsel from his wisdom, help from his power, has loved and been loved, has even adored without understanding his divine nature. But he has been guided like all others, that is Arjuna. But he has been guided like all others through his own egoism, and the counsel, help and direction have been given in the language and received by the thoughts of the ignorance. Until the moment when all has been pushed to the terrible issue of the struggle on the field of Kurukshetra and the avatar stands at last, still not as a fighter, but as a charioteer in the battle car which carries the destiny of the fight, he has not revealed himself even to those whom he has chosen. You see, look at this avatar who has been everything except the divine. He could not reveal himself as the divine. Only twice he does, I suppose. One, when he goes and shows himself to Dhritarashtra, the blind king. And the second time, Arjuna sees him in the war field. So those were the two times when he reveals himself as the Lord. Rest of the time, he is the human divine. And that's why he says, even in the great Mahabharata, he doesn't come as an avatar. Arjuna says, I want you as my charioteer. He says, I'll come. You see the humility of the avatar and the divine humility that you see in Sri Aurobindo. So, there's a little poem, God. Have you read that? Some people must have read that. What is that line? That he is known as God by what? There's something, I forget, I don't want to misquote. Please bring that line tomorrow. Because of that he is known as God, because of his humility. I think he hesitates not even to be the clod, and therefore we know by his humility that he is God. So God is one who does not have the hesitation even to become a clod. So that is the meaning here, that the great Lord, he sits as a charioteer. He doesn't say, I will rule, I will do that. So he says, still not as a fighter, but as a charioteer of the battle car, which carries the destiny of the fight. He has not revealed himself even to those whom he has chosen. Well, I think we have one more paragraph or two paragraphs, small ones and short ones, but for me, when I speak, the short becomes long and the long becomes longer, so better. Well, while speaking of that, I just discovered in the Gita, in my book, this picture of the Lord when he reveals himself, and this is from one of the books I had. So it's very timely that I saw that. So he reveals himself in his own grandiose transcendental aspect.